Okay, today I want to talk about the connection between physics, technologies, and medicine. Medicine is a sector that critically depends on progress in other branches of science. Most of the drugs are generated with chemical processes. The most advanced diagnostic is done by instruments which are essentially coming from physics application, from physics experiment and physics technologies. It's a long story. I mean, medicine started to get inputs from physics at the beginning, essentially, of the last century. I remind you that in 1901 a Nobel Prize was awarded to Wilhelm Röntgen. Röntgen was the person that somewhat serendipitously discovered the X-rays. And when he understood essentially what X-ray were able to provide as a way of taking a picture of what is inside essentially a body, he took a radiography of the hands of his wife, whose name was Anna Berthe. Actually, the wife was scared at death. Probably she never forgiven the husband for taking this picture, which was taken essentially in 1895. But this, you see, there is the ring which appears on one of the finger. But a lot of progress have been made from that point, although radiography is still something that is commonly used today for diagnostic. I'll go to a story of how the technologies for medicine have been developed later. But I want to remind one more things about Röntgen. Röntgen was really a remarkable person. I mean, he got a Nobel Prize, deserving it, for the discovery of X-rays, and that's pretty normal. What is less normal is that he did not patent the discovery, although he understood, I mean, when he saw essentially the radiography of the hands of his wife, he understood precisely what was the potentiality of his discovery. But he didn't patent the things and said that everybody was free to use it. And the money that he got for the Nobel Prize, he devolved to its university for continuing the research in the field, something that is not happening every day, I would say. The next big progress, or not particularly in order of putting operation, but there is some sort of sequence that you will see, is the nuclear magnetic resonance. The nuclear magnetic resonance got renamed after a couple of years that it was used as a magnetic resonance imaging, actually MRI. Actually, I think that this is a story that should be told to loudly. I mean, the word nuclear was eliminated because people were scared by the fact that you have to do with a machine that does something with something nuclear. I think this is a stupid thing, but things goes as this, so we have to accept that this happened. So what you see now is a modern machine for the magnetic resonance, and on the right side you see what kind of quality of images that you can get from this technique. Now, this technique is a very complex one. It's not even easy to describe, but the basis are at least are known pretty clearly. First of all the process involves the Fourier transform of what you essentially record from the machine in form of electric signals. And I remind you that the Fourier transform were appropriately invented, given to humankind by Jean-Baptiste Joseph Fourier. That, not strangely, given the time when he used to live, was at the same time a physicist, a mathematician, and an historian. For at the time, I would say, culture was one. It was not subdivided into many parts as we have today. Then another contribution fundamental was given by Cornelius Jacobus Goerter, who essentially had the idea that the nuclear magnetic moment could be measured actually, and also the how to induce a resonance and the better even measure it. The real measurement, the real proof was given by Isidore Rabi in 1938. You see, time to transform some idea into an instrument is long. The next step was the one when Bloch and Purcell invented the way to precisely measure the nuclear magnetic moment. Because, of course, if you want to have something which is as precise or as neat as you have seen in the picture, that is the output of magnetic resonance, you have to have a very precise measurement of the magnetic moments. And this ended up in a nice story that after when the machine was first for the first time the machine a machine for measuring the magnetic for doing the magnetic resonance of a body was put in operation. So the images were produced essentially. This was a joint work of Paul Lauterbur and Peter Mansfield. And you see, Lauterbur was a chemist and Mansfield a physicist, and they got a Nobel Prize in medicine. So you see that after all, the Swedish Academy is a virtuous example of interdisciplinarity. I'm not aware of a doctor. Medical doctor that got a Nobel Prize in physics, for example. So, I mean, no, but what I want to say is that in medicine, medicine recognizes the relevance of the application which comes from developments in other field of science, like chemistry or physics or engineering. Today, if you at the time then the first magnetic resonance were made, the magnetic field that you could produce on a large volume were very limited, essentially. I mean, you could get a Tesla with certainly not with a compact object. Now, using the developments on the technology of superconducting magnets, which is mostly due to the need for superconducting magnets for accelerators. I remind you that in the LHC at CERN, you have superconducting dipoles niobium-tin, which titanium, which reaches 9 Tesla, and it is thought that for the next CERN machine, the so-called Future Circular Collider, you will need magnets of the order of able to reach 14, 16 Tesla, based on a technology of niobium and tin. And as you see in the bottom part of the transparency on the right side, this is a prototype actually of a 14.6 Tesla magnet. It's a prototype, of course. Now, if you want to produce in reality in many pieces. You have to industrialize it and make it commercial. But all the elements for saying that that these things can be done are on the floor. Now, what does it mean having a 10 Tesla magnet for a resonance rather than one Tesla magnet? Well, essentially, the precision depends on the strength of the magnetic field, or alternatively on the time that you spend inside the machine. And now I'm not sure you are young people, so hopefully you never had to undergo a magnetic resonance. I did once in my life for an injured knee. And I spent this boring 20 minutes inside a machine that essentially the only things that you perceive is a loud noise like boom, 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 which are the oscillation of the magnetic field and the electric field. Of course, having a machine employed for half an hour for taking one picture is something that has a cost, because this means that having one equipment you can only process a certain number of patients per day. So if you could have a machine that does it 10 times faster, which means with 10 times higher magnetic field in first order, then you could have a great benefit, because you could process many more patients per day, so make it even cheaper the process and the cost for the health system or the patients, depending on who is going to pay. There are, to my knowledge, examples of, at least I've seen personally one in Russia, of a 13 Tesla resonance for little animals. And I have seen images of a cat taken with 13 Tesla. Apparently the magnetic field doesn't make any harm to you, unless you have some piece of iron inside your body. So another evolution, another instrument that is fundamental for diagnostic is an evolution of the X-ray radiography, which is the computerized axial tomography. Nickname is CAT. And when you are prescribed it, they say that you have to get a CAT scan. So a CAT scan is, again, the quality, you can get a total body CAT scan, you can get the CAT scan for a finger if it's needed, but you see the quality of the images that you get, you get on the right side. Now you could ask what the Beatles, famous singers, famous band of when I was young, what the Beatles have to do with it. Well, the Beatles have a very important role. I don't know if you know this. That's just to remind you who the Beatles were. It's important because there was one of these two guys. These two guys are the one that essentially produced the first machine that took a scan of a body again, like Lauterbur and Mansfield for the NMR, for the resonance, Cormack and Hounsfield. Now, they got again a Nobel Prize in Medicine, although Cormack was a physicist and Hounsfield was an engineer in 1979. Now, the point is that Hounsfield was working at EMI. EMI was the company that produced the long playing of the Beatles. And Hounsfield was a character by himself, so he was not particularly following the prescription of the EMI management. He liked to play with something very personal. And since at the point EMI was so rich, because the Beatles used to sell so many long playing that EMI was the richest of all the old companies in the musical market, they told him, okay, if you like to play, we have plenty of money, take the money and do whatever you like. And with the money essentially that was given into from EMI, he developed the CAT scan. It's an example that tells that companies are not generous by themselves, but sometimes in special circumstances, when they have so much money that they don't know how to better invest, they take a risk to pursue avenues which are not obviously the main one. The next in line is something which is even more close to technologies of particle physics. This is the positron electron tomography. Positron electron tomography is a very easy process to describe. You inject a molecule into the body of a patient. The molecule is a kind of sugar, which is called FGD. FGD, the F of FGD stays for fluorine. It's a kind of fluorine that radioactively decays with a positron, by emitting a positron. A piece of antimatter. So the positron cannot travel much into the w from wherever it is released because immediately it finds surrounding electrons and annihilate into two photons. The two photons are emitted then back to back. So if you put around the body of the patient a ring of something that is able to measure the energy of a photon. You know that when you measure, not probably in a sense that you wouldn't even need to measure the energy, okay? Because it's enough that you measure a coincidence of two signals which are back to back. That would be enough to reject the background. However, measuring roughly the energy, it helps from taking some residual noise. So you see that from each individual decay, you can trace a line, and the line pass through the place where the FGD molecule essentially has been mostly absorbed. Of course, you cannot exclude that the molecule is absorbed everywhere in the body, but since it's a sugar, and if you have a tumor, the tumor is avid of eating sugar, so most of the FGD will end up in the place where your tumor is. So you see that collecting many of these rays, you have a lot of lines which intersect, and eventually they will describe precisely a portion of what is inside your body and is potentially causing trouble to you. Okay? So this is positron electron tomography. Now, if you take this ring of crystal, of course, this is a schematic. This ring of crystal by itself would not be enough. But you see that if you now rotate the ring of crystal, now you orientate with the degree of freedom that you have, say, plus minus 45 degrees or something like that, then you get a 3D description of the region you are interested in it. Okay, so you see that eventually you have a 3D mark of the place on the place. This very red region is where you are going to pee out the isotope at the end in the next couple of hours. The lifetime of fluorine is 11 hours, as far as I remember. So you will pee out your fluorine for some time, and you cannot discard your pee in a trivial way because it's radioactive. So you see that the idea of tomography came out from particle physics detectors called crystal calorimeters that are electromagnetic calorimeter which are used in high energy physics experiments surrounding essentially the collision region of a collider and able to detect the electrons and the photons that are emitted by the product in the collision. It's a nice way, for example, to discover the Higgs boson with this calorimeter, kind of calorimeters, because the Higgs boson decays into two photons, and so you measure the two photons in the calorimeter and you reconstruct the invariant mass of the two, and sometimes you find the Higgs over the background. Okay, so essentially the PET machine is a single ring of what in high energy physics is an entire 4 pi detector. I have to remark one thing that until the experiment L3 was done at CERN, at LEP in particular, all the tomographies were the electron positron tomography was performed with the sodium iodide crystals, which are good but not as good, because what you want is not an invasive object, heavy object, bulky object. And the sodium iodide is not a very short radiation length, so you need the crystals of a certain length. But then L3 experiment demonstrated the extremely good performances of bismuth orthogermanate, BGO, in producing 11,000 crystals of it in qualifying a producer in China, which is called SICAS. And from that day on, all the tomography started to be done with BGO crystals. SICAS became rich and monopolized the PET market. Of course, the experiments didn't gain anything out of it. Of course, you can combine technologies, so you can combine the tomography with the magnetic resonance, and this is an image of an entire body which has been examined with this technique. Now, let's go. As far as you have understood until now, most of the instruments, most of the tools I've shown to you are used in diagnostic. Okay, so they tell you if you have a tumor or if you have something like. Or if you have a fracture, or if you have a bone which is broken, or you have something some blood that's coming out somewhere, especially with the magnetic resonance that's easy to spot. And so at this point, there is a doctor that looks at the output of your examination and decide what to do. No one of the things I've shown to you is used for actually as a therapy for your illness or your problem. But now let's see what you could do with particles in therapy. One, suppose now that you have with a CAT scan or with the tomography. You have identified a region of your body where there is a tumor. Now, there are, as you know, many ways to attack the problem. One way to attack the problem is going under surgery, and there is a surgeon that at his best remove the region of the tumor and around. Okay, this is way number one. It is usually followed by a very expensive and a bit annoying chemotherapy or immunotherapy, some kind of therapy that try to eliminate all the remnants, if any, or suppress the possibility that the remaining part of the tumor can degenerate into metastasis that will go and affect another organ with a destructive problem that cannot be anymore put under control. So, but you see, particles are able to inflict damage to cells, eh? Any kind of particles as an energy, And if the energy is deposited inside a cell of your body, the cell get either damaged or destroyed, essentially, or killed. Now you have to understand how to best make use of particles for destroying your tumors and not destroying the rest of your body, which is a very interesting problem, right? So until a few years ago, essentially all the efforts were concentrated in improving the performances of machine that irradiate your tumor with photons. Okay, in fact they are called gamma rays. In fact, they are called gamma knife. And you see from the picture, which, well, the machine is a bit terrifying. The picture on the right side is even more, I would say, because you see that the photons are emitted from different sources and are collimated by collimators, and they end up into a point. I would say that the picture is a lot misleading, okay? Because the photons will not stop in that point. Some photon will be absorbed in that point. But photons have a probability of propagation that goes well beyond your entire body, I would say, okay? So there are photons that stops with an exponential law, okay, from the moment they get into your body to the point that they get out from your body. So only a little fraction of them will actually interact with the malignant cell that you have in your tumor. So this means that you will get a lot of radiation, and most of it will affect healthy tissue and not the one that should be it. There are parts of your body where this is not particularly relevant. After all, you have to balance the risk of destroying good cells with the risk of dying anyhow by that tumor. But there are parts of your body, and that one is the most unfortunate picture that they could do. It's probably in the skull, because you don't want cells of your brain to be randomly destroyed by photons. So probably photons are not the best solution for treating a tumor in the brain. So a step forward was made by thinking that instead of photons, you can use protons. Okay, charged particles, not neutral particles. Now, protons, of course, have a disadvantage that they have to get inside your body and they lose energy by ionization. So if they have to penetrate by centimeter, or 10, 15 centimeter inside your body, they should have an energy which exceed a certain threshold. The second point, well, the damage they inflict along their trajectory is limited to the fact that they ionize with a certain loss of energy per unit of length or per unit of density, if you like, of the matter you pass through. But the great advantage of the photons is that if you tune precisely, you know that the cells you want to kill are, I don't know, 10.4 centimeter deep inside your skull, and you take a precise resonance of your skull and then precisely measure the density, precisely measure everything, then you can make the proton stop precisely where you want. The great advantage is that when the proton stops, range out, how to say in physics, it deposits most of its energy in a single point. So the cell where that specific protons will lose most of its energy, the energy of that proton will be of the order 200 MeV actually, that cell get certainly destroyed. Okay, there is no way out. Well, so machines have been started everywhere in the world on this principle. These machines are very common. Okay, there are machines. A couple of these machines in many countries in the world. I will show the drawing of one later, pointing out to a problem. But people made another step forward. After all, the physicists are researchers that want to perform the best of their research, and then will be the medical doctors that decide whether they want this improvement or not. Physicists thought that carbon ions, light ions, okay, light ions, say carbon, for example, but one could debate about helium or about neon. Ions are even more effective than protons, okay, because the energy is much higher, so when they knock a cell, that will be the final story of that cell. Okay, so accelerators have been built with the idea of using at the same time protons or carbon ions. Of course, here you need an accelerator which is pretty big, because this carbon ion have a few GeV per nucleon. So this is one example of the accelerator. This is in Italy, in Pavia, National Center for Hadrotherapy, Oncologic Hadrotherapy. And this has been built, the project was done at CERN and has been built by the Italian National Institute for Nuclear Physics in Pavia. And it has the possibility of curing three patients at the same time in three different, of course, treatment all. And has already cured more than 1,000 patients and in operation since a couple of years. Okay, so now what's the difference between here you see another application, a potential application of the thing. Of course, if you irradiate the skull, there is no problem, because you put a mask on the skull of the patient, you keep it steady, and so you irradiate without problem. But suppose that you want to irradiate an internal organ. That organ will move because the patients will be breathing. So you see that you have to shoot the beam only when you have a fair chance to hit the target. So you have to have sensors of breathing, which tells you how things are moving, and you only open the collimator of the beam when the organ is that you want to irradiate is in the right position. So this is what essentially the explanation in a single picture of what the Bragg peak means. You see that for the photons, okay, photons, so you have the black line, which is an exponential. Photons coming from cobalt 60 source is an exponential. So you see that if your tumor is at, suppose that is at 25 centimeter depth or in water equivalent, and then you can count what is the fraction that gets into the tumor and what is the fraction that gets into the body. So it's really a very tiny fraction that gets into the tumor with respect to what you get everywhere. With the protons, which is the blue line, you see that there is an ionization that is constant for most of the track length. Then of course it starts to increase approaching the end energy, and then there is a sudden release of energy at the very end. Carbon ions have essentially the same virtue of the protons, with a little disadvantage, one decides to admit, that carbon can fragment. So the fragments can keep going after the energy release at the right position. Of course, ideally, one would have the what is called ideal, would have all the energy deposited precisely there, but this is not possible for what we understand. Now, in the two pictures on the bottom, you see the difference between radiation with X-rays, with photons, on the left side, and with protons on the right side. So you see that, for example, here, the brain with the photons gets photons everywhere. Of course, most of the photons they are concentrated in the region, since there are 9 beams that come to the same spot. While with the protons, you only get the tumor irradiated. Of course, it comes with a cost. The difference between the photons and the carbon ions is like when you want to buy a football player, okay? So if you want to buy perhaps you remember the goalkeeper of the Liverpool when they played against Real Madrid, the final of the Europe Championship, Mr. Karius, that probably if you want to buy Mr. Karius, they will give you Karius with some money. So the X-rays are really cheap. A proton single room comes in the order of few millions, okay? So the cost of the players are a bit outdated, okay? Now there are other players I could put. If you want a proton center with many rooms to treat many patients at the same time, you go in the dozens, tens and tens of millions. If you want a facility for carbon ions, then it's probably equivalent to what Manchester City promised to Leo Messi, but Leo Messi didn't go, so we don't know the real value of the guy, but we know that the cost of the synchrotron for heavy ions will be in the order of 150 to 200 millions. Now, there are techniques which allows you to see essentially how the cells, this is a single cell, how the particles going into a cell interact with the cell itself. So you see that it's not that the particles, this is a normal ionizing, minimum ionizing particle. So you see that you have many hits, but not a single dramatic event which blows up the cell, which instead with protons and carbon ions at the end of the range will happen. Okay, by now probably 150 centers, sorry, in operation or projected by next year. Most of the Western country, I would say, are equipped. Also China is equipped. South Africa was equipped, actually. South Africa stopped to the operation of this center. And most of them are single room machine, single room machine, which I think I have. Okay, I have to skip one thing and go back here to developments. Now, single room machine are interesting things because you see here you are. Oh, okay, there is a principle that I didn't tell you. You cannot move the patient. Okay, that's the requirements that the medical doctors put as a must. So the patient has to stay on a bed. It has to be possibly kept locked on the bed, and you cannot even think to move the patients, rotating it or putting at an angle or whatever. So the beam, you want the beam to come from different angles, but if the beam comes always in the same direction, even scanning left, right, or top, bottom, you will not be able to effectively cover the entire area of a solid tumor. So you want the beam to come from different angles. This you can do since you cannot rotate the patient with respect to the beam, you can rotate the beam with respect to the patient. This is the concept of a single room proto-machine, which essentially, the machine is the object which is on top of the patient and rotate around the patient with a wide span in angle, okay? But it's not even, with protons it's easy because the protons are 250 MeV, so you can rotate the protons around without much trouble with some reasonable magnetic field. However, if you want to do the game with ions, that is much, much, much more difficult because the rigidity of the beam. This is a beam of a few GeV per nucleon. So you cannot hope to do the things that you're doing with protons. In fact, the only existing object is this tiny monster in Heidelberg. Which is an object 25 meters long, 13 meters of diameter, 700 tons of weight, with a field of 1.8 Tesla. You don't want that in an hospital, right? I mean, this is in a research center, of course. You cannot go to an hospital and propose such a solution. I think you will be kicked out or possibly taken in, actually, to another division, not the one of oncology. So now again, particle physics comes to your help. I don't know how many of you knows about ATLAS experiment in CERN. Okay, ATLAS experiment has very nice toroids, which are used to measure the momentum of particles. So imagine that you have the patient, and imagine that you have a set of toroids around the patient that are able to do what is sketched really in these two drawings I made, as you say, this is the famous back of the envelope drawing, right? Suppose that you are able to do that. Ah, that's interesting. So you can enter essentially the patient from any direction you want. And of course, you have only to tune the direction and the energy of the beam. So this might be the idea that you build a toroid, well, a set of toroids, and the patient is inside. So this could be done, at least on paper. You could have a 14 Tesla object. Again, superconductivity here is the key. The mass of this object would not exceed the 50 tons. You see, it's not an iron magnet, okay? This is an empty magnet. It's in air. It costs a bit in current and energy. And of course, it has to be superconducting. So this could be the object, okay? After all, if you get inserted into this object, you've not even worry. If you could see everything which is outside, probably you would be scared at that. But if you are inserted in this machine, you don't know what's going to happen. You would accept, probably. Okay, so these are the developments in hadron therapy. There is a last hadron. We went from photons to protons and ions because these are charged particles that you can deal with much better. But there is still a neutral particle that has not been exploited until now for therapy. These are the neutrons. Now, the neutrons are peculiar particles because, of course, you cannot really focus them, so you cannot have a beam which hit precisely with protons, so you can get a precision of much better than a millimeter on where you go. With the neutrons, so you can certainly you cannot. But this might be an advantage. Think to a tumor which has already produced a metastasis, suppose a metastasis in the liver or metastasis in the lung. Then a diffused beam of neutrons would help a lot. But now you have to convince the neutrons to interact, which is not easy. We interact with the tumor, actually, you know, not because in principle at this point the tumor is made by the same amount of water that your cell contains, the same amount of water that all the normal cell of the body contains. So how do you convince the neutron to interact with the cells of your tumor? Well, you have to inject in the patient some chemical product, which is the equivalent or the FGD used in the PET therapy. So some molecule that sugar that preferentially goes into the tumor and contains a molecule, a nucleus, a nuclei, contains nuclei that have an extremely high absorption cross-section for neutrons. For example, boron. So if you made a pharmacy of this molecule, you inject in the patient, the tumor will be absorbing avidly these things and will be loaded by boron. So now the neutron arrives, the neutron goes through your body without making particular harm. These are thermal neutrons. But when it encounters a boron nucleus, it makes it disintegrating into lithium and alpha, and this is such a tragic process that the cell will be destroyed because the alpha particle or the lithium particle will have a range less than 10 micron, and this is the level of selectivity that you want. Now this therapy has been tested, okay, in the around the world. It has been tested at nuclear reactor. Now, unfortunately, you see a scary picture at the very center. I mean, you don't want to be treated into a nuclear reactor. I'm pretty sure that you don't want. So at the level of test, this was done, even with some success. But it's not the way to go. So you have to develop an accelerator that produces an intense neutron beam of thermal neutrons, and then you have to, of course, you have to apply this with the same technique that was shown before to a patient. For example, the machine that could be used are radio frequency quadruples that are being produced in many places in the world and should give the performances that you want. Now, so I wanted to make a summary of where physics can help in medicine. So, particle therapy, radiobiology, now this neutron therapy, the combined treatment, of course, dosimetry, the CAT scan, the imaging with magnetic resonance, the tomography, the production of radioisotopes for the medical pharmacy, new particle accelerator for medical application, and of course, Monte Carlo simulation of the processes. Now, just in short, one thing is the following: when you want to assess what you are doing with the hydrotherapy, so you shoot the beam into the tumor, right? But you want to know actually what you are doing. So you have to monitor around. You have to put monitor around, and this monitor usually are based on the annihilation of positrons that are produced in the process, so are essentially of the PET type. However, a lot of particles are produced when essentially this carbon ion interacts with the cell. So if you put around detectors for all kind of particles, you might be able to better identify what you have done. These objects are being tested, actually. It's not something ideal. They are under test in clinical trials, okay? Radioisotopes are very important. I have said about fluorine, about this boron-loaded molecules, but you might need other isotopes, very rare, or very difficult to produce because you need an intense beam of high energy. There are not many cyclotrons in the world that can do it. So the research in this field is extremely important for whoever has a powerful, energetic and intense source of protons, okay? For example, I just mentioned a few of the isotopes that you could produce. There are copper isotopes which are used even in therapy for tumors, zirconium, manganese, strontium, rubidium, gallium, germanium. So essentially you want to provide the pharmacy with a lot of tools, okay? There are another family of actinid that can produce alpha particles that again can be injected in the tumor region and they would actually destroy the tumor at that level. This is one example of somebody that has been treated with actinium-225. You see that essentially how the tumor, prostate tumor, was reduced in 1 year, essentially in 1 year of treatment, okay? But this is a special case. In medicine, you only show the good cases, okay? That's a problem. Statistics in medicine is something that is not like in high energy physics. Okay, imaging, I told you about the possibility of imaging at a very high field. Now the idea is to have a commercial scanner at 7 Tesla or so. This is the last thing I want to mention is this one, okay? Now, you inject a radioisotope to mark the tumor. Suppose that now you are using a surgical technique. You intervene, you remove the tumor. Now, of course, you use the emitted radiation to understand if you have removed all the tumors or not, because most of the radioactivity comes from the region of the tumor. However, the problem is that these photons, as I said, they travel a lot. So in a short time, in the time of the operation, the surgical operation, you are not able really to understand if you have removed all or you have some background that coming from the fact that the photons doesn't give a detailed picture. So the idea is to rather to use electrons, okay? Because the electrons only travels millimeters. So at that point, you need to have a clear picture, much less isotope to inject, and you can extend even the tumors that you want to follow during the operation in this way. Okay, again, this is a picture of the probe that would be operated during the surgical intervention, and you see that the laboratory trials say that you can work up to a level of 0.1 milliliter a tumor, and you can mark them in less than 1 second, only injecting 1 megabecquerel per kilo of yttrium-90, which is the same dose of an FDG injection for the PET scan, okay? So this is in Italian, but I mean, the only thing that counts is the picture. You see, you go and you touch actually the region. You do two things. You examine the tissue that's been removed and during the operation, you look around to see if there is a lot of activity around or not. So in conclusion, I think that the use of physics technologies in medicine has been a long and successful story. Most instruments are fundamental for investigation and identification of pathologies. However, radiotherapy, which makes use of photons, electrons, protons, ions, and hopefully in the near future neutron, is one of the most effective solutions for curing tumors. So my idea is that whoever has got a good idea for application should pursue it, maybe because there is a lot of space in future for this kind of application, and there is a lot of collaboration between physicists and medical doctors. The only things I advise is that even if you have an extremely good idea, before going to the end of your idea and making a product, talk to a medical doctor, because perhaps at the end of your process, the medical doctors will look at you and say, "I don't know what to do with what you have invented." Okay? Here I'm done.
Thanks, Fernando. That's very nice. I think last week you gave us an example of how to apply nuclear physics technologies to cultural heritage, and today we see examples of how they can be or they are applied to medicine. So I think these are extremely good for us physicists to know that many of the things that we are doing find applications in other domains, so that when people are asking us, you know, what is the utility of our research? Mm-hmm. We know we have examples of how to respond.
Yes.
And so we have two aspects: fundamental research to advance the knowledge of humankind and understand nature around us. And then we also have the application of those research, those knowledge to improve quality of life. So I think all of us physicists, especially the young people who are hearing, who have followed your talk, should really keep that in mind, the importance of our field, you know, in all of the human endeavors. So are there people who have any specific questions or comments? I know that there are a number of you guys in medical physics, and you may have comments or you may want to share experience in your countries. So we are now in the discussion session, so please speak up.
So, any curiosity? Any idea for new tools?
So maybe then I will ask a quick question.
Yeah.
So looking at the different development that you were proposing. So I think it's so important to see exactly what Ketavi has mentioned, that this is whether for fundamental aspect or for the application, that we can use those physics aspect and then accelerator, so particle accelerator. Now, the cost of all of that could be somehow as well one of the showstoppers. So if we look at the situation as well in Africa, so what would be your recommendation as well to those young physicists to try to further embark on some research that could be more relevant? We know that looking at the photons, so this is good, but maybe future will lead to more effective technology. So proton could be good, maybe this would be the optimal. Carbon might be expensive. So is neutron some kind of good solution?
No, look, the machine for photons and protons are now completely commercial. Okay, there is no way, I guess, that you can do something cheaper or more effective in photons or protons. Okay, as I said, the photons are affordable in principle by many hospitals. Here you are much below the million dollar range. So I think the photons should be affordable almost everywhere. Protons are in the millions of dollars, and they are essentially commercial. There are few companies, Varian, IBA, Japanese One. So again, here I don't see any margin, because I mean, of course, a reduction of the cost can come from the expansion of the market. Okay, so the number I was mentioning at this level are 150 projected for next year. It will go to 1,000 in some time, but I mean, probably you can expect that we know one order of magnitude more machine will make the cost to be reduced. The frontiers of ions, frontier of neutrons, those are expensive, and I don't see any hope to reduce it substantially on short term, because these are more like a research machine than something that can be commercialized, so produced in series. I guess there are no two the same machine for ions, and the neutrons are at a level of still R&D, medical R&D. So I understand your point. One thing that I believe has a lot of potentials is the line of radioisotopes, okay? Because the radioisotopes can be produced in few places in the world, and they can be more or less expensive. I have no idea about it, but for example, I know that there have been clinical trials very successful with copper, injecting copper for some kind of tumors. And certainly there has been some success in using this very rare and very difficult to produce actinium 225, which has actually been produced at CERN, for what I know. So one of the line of progress which might help in the therapy, not using an accelerator continuously, I mean, to inject the patients, but only to use the accelerator to produce the isotope. That might be an interesting line to go after.
Very good. So some follow-up as well with the Isolde and High Isolde.
Sure, but I mean, yeah. there are few cyclotrons in the world that can do it. There is one in Legnaro, there is one in France, there are in Germany. So Europe is not, actually, there is one in South Africa.
Okay? Yeah, that's right. Actually, Itemba Lab is produces.
Itemba can produce radioisotopes for many, okay? So it's a question of coordination. I think one of the problems is that physics is a large and a very connected community. Okay, medical doctors are many more than physicists, but they are completely disconnected. Okay, so the idea of putting together a network of research is probably the winning part for continent like Africa or even Latin America.
But Fernando, do you think also that governments could play some role, because some of these machines, as you mentioned, could be extremely expensive, and and either there is not enough research funds to commercialize, or there is not enough research money injected.
In Europe, this machine have been the carbon ion machines, the one in Germany, the one in Italy, and the one in Austria have been entirely paid by the government. It was not the hospital. The hospital has not the ability of putting 100 millions on the table. It's out of any question. Mm-hmm. But the problem is that the health system in Europe, I think, is such that it might be convenient for the government to invest in such a machine. I let you think that when a treatment at an accelerator, okay, of a tumor with protons, essentially is reimbursed at a level of 15,000 euro, okay, per 15,000 euro. Now, if you get the chemotherapy is 40,000 euro. Hmm? So at the end of the day, you have to work out the complete economics. Mm-hmm. It's true that at the end we have not the final weapon against the tumor. Okay, sometimes you have to employ radiotherapy and immunotherapy. Sometimes you have to have a surgical operation and immunotherapy. Sometimes we are in tumors. We are still fighting a war. Eh? So more the tools, more hope to have the right combination of the actions that will help to solve the issue. So after all, the cost of having a patient with a tumor, you have to calculate the cost to the health system for as long as he lives with the tumor. Okay, it can be hopefully very long. Sometimes it's shorter, but hopefully it's very long. And he needs continuously assistance and therapies. So it's a complex economics, and the government should be able to work out. Also, you see, these machines, the proton machine have a cost, and so they can treat eventually with the same investment can treat as many more patients as a carbon ion machine. Okay. Mm-hmm. But the carbon ion machine then can be dedicated to this I don't know, 1,000 cases per million sorry, 1,000 cases for 10 million people, okay, of tumors that cannot be treated in any other means, okay? So if you build a machine in a country, it could be a regional machine in a sense, and not necessarily is a national or regional. So these things are complex, but again, you have to follow. But
Fernando, has there been progress also in either miniaturization leading to reduction of cost over time, like we've seen in other technologies where
the cost can be brought down only by serial production. I mean, mm-hmm. As long as you do research, you are talking about. Sorry, I have.
In the meantime, some people have questions or comments, or they want to talk about their own experience in the countries.
I have a problem at home and I have to disappear for less than 5 minutes, okay?
All right. So maybe in the meantime, people can share their experiences, especially people who are in medical physics or medical applications, or people who are thinking about going into those fields, if they have questions or comments, or they are wondering about how that's going to work out. and feel free to talk. If people are not talking, then maybe I will call out some people that I know have been, you know, in medical physics, and some of you I know have already even gotten PhDs in medical physics. So.
Because I agree that it's important to have the African image of what is happening there. So, yes, sir.
Justina, can you talk or can you write something? Congratulations on your PhD. I know you just finished your PhD in medical physics. Justina is an alumnus of ASP 2014 in Senegal. So I see that you are connected. Justina, maybe she disappeared. I don't see her anymore. Let me see. See if there's a... Christine. Okay, so...
Okay.
Yeah. Okay, so you are back. And we are talking about reduction of cost and miniaturization and serial production and so forth.
Look, in this moment, if you think at the commercial proton machine can be rather inexpensive. The problem is that you have to have a civil engineering in the hospital to put the machine or the treatment hall. I mean, you see, there are associated costs and not be easily estimated. Depends, there can be a region where the civil engineering is cheap. The cost of the machine won't change. I don't think that IBA or Varian will make a different price. Well, sometimes they want to enter a market, okay? So they are going to make very good offer because they think that if they start to sell a machine in a specific region, that might open a market. So it's, but still the civil engineering is needed because you have to have the place where to put it, you have the radio protection. And one big advantage is that if you have good engineers, a good physicist in a country, then you could always use the machine at night, for example, extracting the beam and doing some physics with it, okay? Training students or making even some kind of experiment with them, okay? This is what is done. We have one machine. In Italy, there is a proton machine in Trento, and it has a line of research which is used at night for doing some dosimetry or research, biological research. In CNAU, where it is the Hadron machine, there is a research line where you can irradiate samples for industry and you can do other research. So of course at night, I mean, the ethics say that you don't treat the patients at night, okay?
Yeah. Fernando, could you go back to your description of the PET maybe you can explain a little bit the physics, you know, I think, you know, you have the electron positron annihilation there, and then you have those two photons. Maybe you can elaborate a little bit what the physical concepts behind the...
A positron is the counterpart of an electron in the matter, antimatter story or symmetry. So when a positron meets an electron, they annihilate. And the annihilation gives rise to two photons. So now an electron has a mass of 511 kV, and the positron has the same mass, of course. So you have a 1.022 MeV at your disposal, and since the process is a two-body process, the two photons emitted they will share the energy. So there are, these two photons have each 511 kV, and they have to go back to back for the conservation of momentum, because the annihilation is at rest. So the conservation of the momentum implies that they go back to back. At this point, as I said, in principle, would be enough to detect in your detector the energy deposit, even without measuring the energy, okay? It would be only a temporal coincidence, okay? Because these two photons are back to back. However, there is another possible background that comes. Suppose a cosmic ray, okay? Suppose a cosmic ray goes through your detector, also that cosmic ray would produce a signal which is back to back, you know? Top down, mostly, but sometimes left, right. So that would be a background. So you have to give a certain quality in the energy measurement. Not really. I mean, it's not the precision of 1 per mille, you don't care, or even 1%, okay? But in this 500 kV, essentially, if you measure with the 10-15%, 20% resolution is more than adequate. The difference between sodium iodide, which brought to BGO, and actually, it would be much better if you could, in the future, there might be in crystals that are called LISO, okay? Which I will not describe, but the point is that if the faster they are, more are able to reduce the background, of course, because you can narrow the temporal coincidence between the two events. So now, there is a point. The point is that no crystal nor the associated electronics, which is a phototube essentially, is able to reduce to measure the timing with precision better than the nanoseconds, okay? But this is a problem because, you know, at the speed of light, 1 nanosecond is many centimeters. So you will not know the point where the annihilation happened, okay? So you can only trace the contour of the tumor by collecting many rays, okay, and making the envelope of those rays. It would be a great, this makes such that you had to inject quite an high dose of FGD, okay? And this is why it's somewhat unpleasant, because then this isotope fluorine lives as an half-life of 11 hours. So it will stay days, okay, inside your body, emitting a continuous. If you could measure the point where the events originated, then it would be much better, because at that moment you could reduce the dose substantially, okay? But there is essentially the combination of scintillators and phototubes is a no-no, okay? Mm. There is one project which is to use, it has a disadvantage, I tell them, to use liquid argon and silicon photomultipliers. Because liquid argon is extremely fast, and silicon photomultiplier are intrinsically fast. So the combination of liquid argon ring and silicon photomultipliers could really make a picosecond resolution, okay? Tens of picosecond resolution. So that would then make a great improvement. However, this means bringing a cryostat in the hospital. So with all the problems associated to a cryostat that you have to continuously monitor the temperature. So there's a level of assistance that goes a bit beyond pushing a button like you do with this kind of detectors, crystals and normal photomultipliers. Of course, the hospitals are reluctant to hire technicians that performs the operation on this machine. They want essentially a closed box where you push a button and you get the result. There is a limit in the collaboration of physicists with medical doctors, okay? The physicists should not enter the hospital, essentially, okay? So it's very difficult to think to an improvement of this thing. However, there are people working on it.
Other questions? Anybody else has any comments or any questions on the material that has been discussed? Are people motivated to go into medical physics and develop some of these detectors, see how they can be economically applied for Africa? Somebody has a question?
I think nobody starts his career, her career, thinking to become a medical. I think at a certain point of your career, either young, medium age, old, or whatever, you got an idea that might be applicable to an existing detector to improve it for medical physics, or is a completely new detector. At that point, the trigger starts, and you switch, and you become a medical physicist. I mean, I don't think that there is a school of medical physics. There is not even examination in medical physics, right?
Yeah, that's. Yeah, that's no, definitely that's true. I think we have to understand how, at least in our field, there is the possibility of with the knowledge that we gain to go into different directions.
Direction as well, maybe that I would like to emphasize, because you spoke about indeed something that could be very promising as well for adrenal therapy, all those gantry with the toroidal magnet. So I know this is something really exciting and very interesting, is with high field magnets, we could really get something which would get this possibility. So then that could be for our African students as well, some kind of very exciting field that they could join. So whether in theory, because there's a lot of understanding still that is to be developed, and then experimentally. So then that would require more laboratory and maybe much more kind of infrastructure that can be more difficult to have in Africa. But the interesting collaboration as well, potentially, because I know that at CERN there is quite a lot of development there.
Sure. Superconductivity is one of the dominating research field, applied research field for the future. So I think that superconductivity will also help in having a more compact machine. I mean, already the proton. The proton machine for adrotherapy are really something that stays on the table, okay? I mean, the sides. You have seen the sides of the object that rotate around the patient. It's really something very small. And so I guess that... this one, and I mean, this is the accelerator, okay? The accelerator is as big as the patient. And now, forget the structure, the support structure, that's a piece of iron, okay? I mean, the accelerator itself, that is a superconducting accelerator, which has the same, is the same size of the human body that is getting treated. So even for carbon ion, the superconducting accelerator might help. Although there is a problem because you see the, okay, you have to switch, you have to have fast magnets that that switch, because you have to change continuously energy, okay? Because the tumor has goes in a different depth, so you have to go in different depths, and then you have to change the energy. So from burst to burst, you have to do those things. But this is the development of the superconducting magnets that is in progress, okay?
There is a question now. There's a question by Enoch. He's asking how safe is this, the whole application, and putting together a detector like that for.
I think that people are very careful, and I'm not aware of accidents, but of course, nothing is, how to say, I cannot promise that something is 100% safe, okay? Nothing on this earth is 100% safe. I think that everything is done in the way of minimizing the possibility of damaging I mean, the reason why the proton therapy is starting to be applied to internal organs, okay, something that's in the abdomen region, is because you have to be extremely careful about the breathing of the patient, okay? But in the progress, and this is the progress which is done now in with animals, pigs mainly, there is the idea of performing operations in a sense in the heart, okay? Because there is a kind of one of the kind of possible disease that are in the heart, which is an arrhythmia. I don't know if it's called in English. It can only be treated surgically, okay? But the probability of success is of the order of 60%. Okay, and in the other 40%, a fraction doesn't get any help from the operation, and the fraction dies. However, if you don't operate, you die. So the choice is, there is not much choice. With a proton beam, you could cut the nerve which caused this problem. Okay, however, here you have many dimension problem, because the patient's breath and the heart beats, okay? So when you shoot the beam, you have to take in account both these things, okay? So you have probably only one combination, one moment, but that you have to know that moment precisely, when probably the breathing is at the minimum and the heart is between one beat and another. And then you can shoot your beam. But I mean, the clinical trial on animals are extraordinarily successful. So this sooner or later, this will be applied. However, what I want to say is that you have to compare this with the probability that you go under surgery and you come out dead. Okay, which unfortunately is not a per million. Okay.
Okay. So I think we have talked enough. Unless somebody has any hot questions or comments, we have seen an array of application of nuclear physics here, and especially the medical aspects, extremely important for Africa. So. I would like to thank Professor Ferroni. So we will have him back again at some point. And when we have the school, the in-person school, you know, he will come again. Hopefully. Yeah. So
hopefully.
Yeah, let's hope. So
okay.
All right. So thank you very much, Fernando.
Thank you, Christine. Thank you very much. See you.
Yeah. Thank you. And thanks, everybody. So we'll stop here. Ciao.